Good morning. My name is Sophia Suarez. I'm currently the editor-in-chief of the Journal of Law and Liberty at NYU School of Law. I wanted to begin today by thanking the law school, the Classical Liberal Institute, our panelists, our moderators, and all of you for coming and joining us for this year's symposium. As I'm sure you're all aware, this year's symposium focuses on the relationship between medical innovation and the law, specifically administrative and regulatory law. The Food and Drug Administration began in 1906 with the Pure Food and Drugs Act, and its mission was limited to transactions in interstate commerce, leaving most regulation to the states. As the regulatory state increased throughout the 20th century, so did the FDA. In 1938, Congress significantly expanded the power of the FDA by requiring pre-market approval of all new drugs. Subsequent grants of power to monitor competition and pricing further enhanced the agency's scope. Today, the FDA regulates every aspect of the prescription drug market, from safety and testing to advertising and labeling, often drawing critique that its broad authority to regulate accounts for the rising cost of healthcare, leaves those in need of life-saving drugs out to dry, and discourages competition in the drug market. The symposium today seeks to elicit answers to several questions that arise from the scope and the power of the FDA as it pertains to medical innovation. In particular, we should consider whether we need an FDA as large as it is today, and secondly, as new technologies are developed, whether the law should be responding in a piecemeal or categorical fashion. Should review come on the front end or the back end? Should it be a market mechanism or a regulatory scheme that is responsible for review? In answering these questions and others, we have set up two panels and a keynote speaker, Jeff Flyer, former dean of Harvard Medical School. Our first panel will be moderated by Professor Sharkey and will focus on the drug approval process and personalized medicine. Our second panel, moderated by Professor Epstein, will consider how regulation can hamper medical innovation. Again, thank you all for coming, and we hope you enjoyed today's program.
Okay, great. We're going to get started, and we have three wonderful panelists, so without further ado, we're going to have them begin. The basic format is each of them is going to speak for about 10 minutes, and then we're going to have a little bit of panel discussion, and then open things up for some robust Q&A with the audience. So the order in which they will speak will be David Hyman, Professor Hyman, then Jordan Paradise, then Henry Miller.
Thank you, Kathy. Pleasure to be here, and somewhat daunting to be the kickoff speaker, especially because I feel naked without PowerPoint slides. I generally do data presentations, and this is probably the first one in a decade that I haven't done slides for. So I'm going to talk a little bit about whether the FDA should pay attention to pharmaceutical prices in terms of its day-to-day operations. And I approach this not so much as a person who does health law, but as somebody who does competition law issues. I spent a couple of years at the Federal Trade Commission, and that's their sort of day-to-day bread and butter issues. One of the striking things about health law is how segregated the field is internally. So the people who do food and drug law really don't do very much with the people who do general health law. The people who do public health law don't have anything to do with anybody else. And so on and so on. So part of this is to try and forge some linkages between competition law aspects of healthcare law and food and drug law. So historically, if you look at people's attitudes about the FDA, most of the discussion in the popular and academic literature is basically where they are on the Goldilocks spectrum. Are they too fast, too slow, or are they just right? And different political positions have very different takes on that and somewhat different takes at different points in time. And each can point to examples that exemplify their views. And Dr. Miller, somewhat later, is going to argue on one of those, the too slow and the false negatives issue. And the sort of broader point here is to understand that, you know, the sort of classic four-part box, the FDA can approve drugs that it should, flunk drugs that it shouldn't approve, but it can also make two, and those are both sensible and correct decisions, but it can also make bad decisions, and those come in two categories, false positives and false negatives, or type 1 and type 2 errors. False positives are when it approves a drug that it shouldn't, and that causes harm, sometimes horrific harm, to a large population, and false negatives when it fails to approve a drug that it should, or it unduly delays the approval decision, and that can cause harm as well, often horrific harm. The former type of error is quite visible and public and causes all sorts of blowback for the agency, scathing headlines, congressional hearings, the sort of congressional equivalent of crucifixion of the agency personnel responsible, and a sort of scorched earth, although the positive is sometimes you get more money in order to do a better job the next go around. On which see the VA, more on that later. The flip side, though, false negatives are invisible, and unless, you know, advocacy groups organize and argue strongly that the FDA's failure is causing death and disability, those tend not to attract anywhere near the same attention, and in Dr. Miller's paper, he points out there's plenty of hearings for the type 1 errors and no hearings to excoriate agency, or very few hearings to excoriate agency leadership for their slowness in making decisions. So the now former FDA commissioner basically said, we joke that the FDA is viewed as having only two approval speeds, too fast and too slow. Okay. Now, I'm not going to talk about any of that, although I think it's sort of the backdrop for what I am going to talk about, which is whether the FDA should pay attention to prices in making its decisions about what to approve and when to approve it, and to set some priorities within the backlog of requests for approval that it has. And historically, if you look at the agency over an extended period of time, its basic attitude has been, we don't care about cost, we don't care about price. What we care about is approving drugs that are safe and efficacious. We're the quality and safety agency, and once we give it a thumbs up, thumbs down obviously tends to end or at least postpone a decision, the terms on which it changes hands are simply none of our business. Don't bother us about these sorts of things. And I think by and large, that's a position that has certainly stuck across administrations, across time. It's also a position that's caused increasing pushback for the agency, because if you asked a member of the general public or a congressperson, what's the single most important issue in drug policy, I think, you know, the false positive, false negative issue would just not come up. What comes up is drug prices, right? Everybody knows drug prices are a big issue, and you know, you don't need to point to Martin Shkreli or the EpiPen. There's no shortage of examples, and the deeper you dig into this, the more you find examples of sudden and dramatic price increases for generic drugs, which have historically been one of the cost success stories, but also ever-spiraling increases or high price points for branded drugs. Okay, so there's a lot of political pressure for someone to do something about that. And my old agency, the Federal Trade Commission, has done a lot of work in this space in dealing with reverse payments and sort of abuse of the Hatch-Waxman approval process to slow generic entry. But there's a sort of broader set of issues that we're sort of confronting as well. And so the paper, which is quite short, basically argues the FDA should pay attention to drug prices, not because it should set itself up as the drug pricing agency, God help us. You know, they don't have either the right information or the right incentives to try and do that, even if they were interested in doing it. I think the broader point is to view prices in the old tradition of communicating information, and that information is about supply and demand functions, and supply is going to be influenced by the FDA's decision-making process, specifically whether it's sort of sitting on a backlog of drugs that, if approved, would have a significant impact on, and this is obviously going to be primarily in the generic space, not really in the branded space, and the paper ends by making that point quite strongly. The tendency when you're a government agency, speaking as a former government employee, is if there's a backlog, it just means that there was paperwork in your inbox when you showed up today, and there'll be paperwork in your inbox when you show up tomorrow, and there's nice continuing demand for your services. You're not going to get fired. And people, you know, if as long as you're treating everybody in the queue equally, what's the problem, right? You don't have any way of viewing it other than forms that are in your inbox to be processed. Of course, these forms represent drugs whose approval can have significant financial consequences as well as health consequences, although because we're going to focus on generic, I'm mostly talking about cost issues. And so paying attention to pricing information, I submit, is a way of making real to an agency the human cost of its failure to clear the backlog. In exactly the same way that when the Veterans Administration views a waiting list as just things in line that need to be cleared, it views it very differently than Congress, which viewed it as veterans who are being denied needed medical care. Okay, so it's not exactly the same dynamic, but it's nonetheless a way of forcing the agency to confront the consequences for the American taxpayers, who of course are funding the agency, of its failure to timely clear the backlog of generic applications. So that's one aspect of it. The second aspect of pricing is it can communicate information to the agency about not just its inactions, but its actions. So the FDA had an initiative called the Unapproved Drugs Initiative, the UDI, that was an attempt to try and deal with the fact that there were a bunch of drugs on the market that had been grandfathered, and so they'd never been through the full FDA review process because they were being sold prior to 1962 when the amendments to the Food, Drug, and Cosmetics Act went into effect. And so to try and deal with this somewhat embarrassing situation, the FDA said, present us with some information that indicates that the drug is safe and effective, consistent with our statutory mandate, and we'll give you some marketing exclusivity to try and basically move them from the grandfathered status to the legitimately covered by the FDA oversight status. The problem, of course, is if you have a drug that's been used for a long time, all generic, of course, and then you give marketing exclusivity to one entity, they can jack up the price very dramatically without having done very much to deserve that. And that has, again, real financial cost consequences. So if you have gout, colchicine is the sort of classic example here. The price went from 10 cents a tablet to $5 a tablet because a single company presented some a not very impressive study that confirmed what everybody had long known, which was that colchicine was a good drug for the treatment of gout. And there are other examples. A drug called 17-OHP used to prevent premature birth went from $15 per injection to $1,440. That one was enough to attract everybody's attention. And the FDA's response to this was basically to say, well, we have a perfectly fine program to try and deal with our backlog of unapproved drugs, and we're not really all that concerned about it. But if they took pricing seriously, they'd be very concerned about it. So I've got just a couple of minutes left, so let me just conclude by noting that there are other things as well where drug companies can game the FDA approval process to make it harder for there to be generic entry, both by using citizen petitions and by using what are called REMS, the FDA's Risk Evaluation and Mitigation Strategy, which Professor Paradise has written about quite nicely. So long story short, I think the FDA should start paying attention to drug pricing, not because I want to set it up as a price control agency, but because I think it offers a feedback loop for how well or poorly the FDA's actions and inactions are doing and what it ought to be thinking about in terms of its priorities. So the paper concludes with a couple of sort of very brief proposals about things that they ought to do once they start paying attention to prices. One is to coordinate their efforts better with the Federal Trade Commission, which deals with anti-competitive behavior. Two is to take steps to harden their own procedures to make it harder for people to game them. And three is to know their own limits, right? So they ought to pay attention to pricing if it indicates that there's supply dislocations. They ought to pay attention to it if the pricing indicates their monopoly or oligopoly problems, but they really shouldn't pay attention to the pricing of branded drugs because that's not their bailiwick, and none of the things I've talked about really affect it. And they shouldn't pay attention to pricing disparities across countries or pricing that's the result of other governmental policies. Their focus should be the things that they control, and that's the limited sense in which I'm suggesting they should pay attention to pricing. Thank you very much.
Great. Right, hello. I'm happy to be here. I have lost my voice, so I am going to do the best I can to project my voice through the microphone. I am building on the theme about the Food and Drug Administration, and I like to think that I do operate in the realm of the Food and Drug Administration, but I like to think about how it intersects with administrative law and policy, as well as intellectual property law and incentives, looking at how industry is incentivized to develop drugs and medical device products. But today, my paper is in development. I have a few basic ideas that I'm trying to flesh out, and that's what I've done in a draft that I think was just circulated to the panelists, but it should be up available on SSRN quite soon. I want to get it up there in order for folks to take a look at it. What I'm trying to do in this piece is look at the field of precision medicine, and specifically the area known as companion diagnostics, and really explore avenues that the Food and Drug Administration has in front of it to create a more flexible, adaptive way to get companion diagnostics and the drugs that accompany them to market. And the way that the paper attempts to achieve this, and I do have to admit I've only through section 2.5 of 5 thus far, so I haven't really developed all of it, but I am building it based upon the recent federal infusion of money into the Precision Medicine Initiative, the PMI. And I begin the paper tracing presidential funding initiatives, many that you are familiar with. The Human Genome Project is one that we're most familiar with, and I think ties directly to the Precision Medicine Initiative. Getting from the HGP to Precision Medicine is a very clear route. I also look at recent legislative changes that play into this landscape and test what some of those provisions might do for the FDA in order to make the approval process more flexible, specifically for drugs and the companion diagnostics. One issue with companion diagnostics that I've seen is it's this intersection of development from two industries that are not typically having conversations with each other. It's pharmaceutical companies as well as medical device companies that are developing the diagnostic assays that couple with the drug in order to target medicines to specific individuals or sets of patients that have a specific genetic variant or genetic makeup. So the paper proceeds starting with this general historical overview of genomics and precision medicine and really how we got to where we are right now. A lot of the promise with the Human Genome Project we're just now starting to realize. It traces the development of funding in that area and a lot of the hype associated with personalized medicine, pharmacogenomics, and now we've got this new phrase that's really being touted for funding purposes, precision medicine, and what exactly does that mean? And I couple the development of precision medicine with the ongoing development in next-generation sequencing and the ability to sequence someone's entire genome and how that might impact the way that we think of medicine. And that's really how precision medicine is envisioned. I then go through, and I think this is a useful tool because as folks in the FDA realm often do, we criticize how the FDA isn't going fast enough, or they're going too fast. They've approved the wrong drugs. They haven't done required enough post-market studies. And really, it's a function of the statutory regime and the regulations that the FDA has promulgated to implement that statutory regime. And I've been really keeping up with developments in the legislative area, especially with the recent 21st Century Cures Act. I think there is a lot of rich provisions in there, a lot that will allow the FDA to use a more flexible approach when they are considering approval of certain types of products, and companion diagnostics are one of them. So the second part of the paper traces these recent legislative actions. And I start with the Affordable Care Act. And most of you probably think, what does the Affordable Care Act do for the Food and Drug Administration? But there is Title VII in the Affordable Care Act is a provision that creates a streamlined, abbreviated process for approval of biosimilars, which is a new pathway to market. It has similarities with the generic drug approval process, but it is distinct. And that's one very important feature of the Affordable Care Act that specifically directs the Food and Drug Administration to develop guidance and regulations in that area. I then focus a bit on the FDA Safety and Innovation Act of 2012, and that is the piece of legislation that introduced the breakthrough therapy status for drugs. And previous to that, there was priority review, fast track, and accelerated approval, but the breakthrough therapy status is really a very thorough set of provisions allowing pharmaceuticals that have promise for an unmet need in life-saving treatments to get those products developed faster. And it dovetails with a number of provisions that are also contained in the 21st Century Cures Act. And the 21st Century Cures Act, signed very recently into law by President Obama, mid-December of 2016, creates a breakthrough therapy process for medical devices. And I think that is really key and is going to be key for the FDA as they consider how to get companion diagnostics and the related pharmaceuticals or biologics to market, because it gives ample flexibility and adaptability, I believe, for the FDA to classify products as having breakthrough status and get them through review and approval faster. And I also focus a bit on the other provisions in the 21st Century Cures Act. There's many of them. I don't know how many of you have actually read through this very dense piece of legislation, but it does a number of things for the FDA or to the FDA, many mandates for the FDA to take into consideration new things that they haven't taken into consideration before when considering safety and efficacy for drugs and medical devices. There are provisions on how the FDA needs to take the least burdensome means possible when analyzing and reviewing medical devices. The FDA needs now also to make public patient experience data, which is very specifically defined in the statute, but patient experience data when they're approving a new drug. So this needs to be made publicly available, which expands the type of information and data that is publicly available following following a new drug approval. And there's many more provisions in there that I detail in my paper, but I think the breakthrough therapy status and a number of the new medical device flexibility provisions are really important. And I then focus a bit on the FDA's very interesting procedural story behind regulation of laboratory-developed tests. This is an area where the FDA has historically exercised enforcement discretion on tests that are developed in a laboratory, not subject to CLIA. They have taken a different approach in the last couple of years. They've held public meetings and have really looked at how to regulate laboratory-developed tests under the standard class 1, 2, and 3 medical device tiered system. And it's been provocative. Industry has responded. And in January, the FDA took an interesting move in deciding not to issue final guidance on the
a final rule on the notice of proposed rulemaking that they had actually put forth, and instead said, we want to seek more stakeholder input, and they issued a memo that detailed their vision of what regulation of laboratory developed tests ought to look like, and I think that's provoking a lot of conversation. The paper then discusses traditional oversight models by the FDA, and these are, when looking at regulation by an administrative agency, fairly rigid categories that the FDA typically adheres to, whether it's a biologic or a drug or a medical device. And as we're seeing precision medicine and products develop as a result, they don't fit nicely into those categories. And the FDA has had to adapt through the Office of Combination Products, through guidance documents specifically for development of companion diagnostics. And there are a number of companion diagnostics on the market. I think there's 19 or so of them right now. So the FDA has adapted and on a case-by-case basis figured out how to get these products on the market. But I think they can do a better job given the new framework that they've been given with recent legislation. So I detail that history, and I detail the potential for flexibility in that area. And I give a couple of suggestions. And I end the paper with some thoughts on not merely the regulatory structure, but some of the other hurdles for implementation and development of products in these areas. And one of the big ones, as I mentioned earlier, is the traditional division between medical device industry and pharmaceutical industry. They have different models, they have different incentives, they have different costs, and it has been really hard, and the regulatory hurdles aren't necessarily what's holding up these types of products. It's the fact that when you have the development of a drug that's a pharmacogenomic drug targeted to a specific genetic variant or set of individuals, the companion diagnostic that goes along with it needs to be developed by individuals and an industry that has knowledge of the medical device approval processes. And those two are traditionally two different players in this realm. And so how can we explore incentives for co-development of these types of products? And so I end looking at a few options for incentives and innovations in this area to bring these two players to the table in a more efficient way. So thank you. I look forward to questions and comments.
I do have slides. Let's see. This will work. So. Okay. Thank you. I'm a recovering regulator. I was at FDA for 15 years, mostly as the biotechnology czar, and part of the time as special assistant to the FDA commissioner, Frank Young. So I did a lot of things, different things for him during that period. As you'll appreciate, FDA is ubiquitous, regulating products worth more than $1 trillion, some 25 cents of every consumer dollar, and other speakers have touched on some of the product classes, drugs, biologics, veterinary drugs, medical devices, food and food additives, and most recently, tobacco products. Part of FDA's influence lies in it being a so-called gatekeeper agency. Affirmative approvals are required for most products, most foods being an exception, but for products like drugs and biologics and devices, certainly, they have to issue approvals in order for those products to be marketed legally. Regulated industry is subject to feels intimidation from FDA, and they fear retaliation if they complain too vocally, too bitterly about FDA's decisions. And that fear of retaliation is somewhat justified. Unfortunately, the trade associations, most notably pharma and bio, have been exceedingly weak. And we're seeing that now in their lobbying perhaps improbably, for a status quo candidate for FDA commissioner instead of for an aggressive reformer. FDA has problems of several kinds. Structural, for example, the FDA commissioner reporting directly to the Secretary of Health and Human Services, who most often over the past 40 years has not been a medical professional. cultural. Cultural is interesting because notwithstanding the sorts of initiatives that Professor Paradise just outlined, breakthrough drug classification, priority review, accelerated approval, if the will isn't there among FDA reviewers and managers, these products will not get through. So to give you an example, my little team reviewed the first biopharmaceuticals in 1982, human insulin. And I guess I hadn't received the memo about the required foot dragging, because we approved those human insulins in 5 months at a time when the average for all NDA approvals was 31 and a half months. So if there's motivation to do it, it can be done, whether or not there are these mechanisms for more rapid approval. David Hyman spoke of the distorted incentives and disincentives, the type 1, type 2 dichotomy, which underlies a lot of this cultural malaise. And then there are simply managerial problems. The managers need to overcome the fear of the type 1 terrors, as I've called it, and to override some of that cultural malaise. And then in the paper, I won't belabor these too much because they're discussed in the paper, there are a number of examples of FDA dysfunction. Pirfenidone is a drug for idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, a lethal condition for which there were no treatments at the time. Pirfenidone was approved in Japan in 2008, in the EU in 2011, but not in the US until 2014. During that period between the Japan and US approvals, some 150,000 Americans died of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, many of whom could have at least had some life extension had the drug been available. The pro-gabapentin story is an interesting example of moving the goalposts. This drug is identical to gabapentin, except that it's a precursor, so it's metabolized in the body to gabapentin. This drug was evaluated and approval was sought for restless leg syndrome. And the gabapentin had been approved some years before and was found to be a very safe and effective drug for uncontrolled epilepsy. The company for progabapentin went through all of the testing, the animal testing, the clinical testing, and then at the very end, FDA said, well, there's an increase in pancreatic cancer in animals, in rats, and so the drug is not approvable. But they knew from the gabapentin testing that there was increase in pancreatic carcinoma in rats that are prone to that. It was not felt to be a problem that translated well to humans. And in any case, gabapentin had been used for years safely in humans. So why would FDA let the company go through all of this testing knowing that the animal testing, preclinical testing, had shown cancer in rats and that they were not going to approve the drug ultimately? Just bad management, bad decision making. And in addition to moving the goalposts, as you'll hear in a moment, sometimes FDA simply takes down the goalposts for a period of time. Rotarix is a vaccine for rotavirus, a serious and sometimes fatal GI infection in children. And this product had been on the market for a while, and then with new, more precise testing methods, it was found that there were fragments of pig virus DNA in this, a virus that's not known to be infectious to anything. The FDA commissioner asked for, quote unquote, a pause in administering the vaccine, even though these fragments of DNA were present in the preparations that underwent the clinical testing for safety and efficacy. So that product had been found to be safe and effective, and yet FDA asked for a pause, which made no sense. They were somewhat confident in doing this because there was a second vaccine on the market, and then when that was tested, that was also found to have the fragments of pig DNA, and FDA waved their hands and said, oh, never mind, we'll just forget the whole thing. The AquaAdvantage salmon story is an awful one. It's a faster-growing salmon, contains an extra growth hormone gene that causes the salmon, farmed salmon, to grow 40% faster than its wild cohorts. It took FDA 13 years to decide how they were going to regulate this. Characteristically, they chose the most burdensome, the most expensive route, and they regulate the salmon as though it were a veterinary drug. It took them another 5 or 6 years to decide that this really was a salmon and was okay to eat, but the total involvement with FDA was 22 years. The Oxitec mosquito is another awful story. It's a mosquito that's intended to control the pathogenic mosquitoes, Aedes aegypti, that spread Zika virus and a number of others. FDA should not have had jurisdiction, should not have accepted jurisdiction in the first place, but they took 5 years to approve the first field trial. And then finally, on January 18th, just before the administrations changed, they decided that they shouldn't have jurisdiction and punted it to EPA. So there are a number of reforms that FDA should have, could have, and that becomes more likely with this new administration. Some of these possible reforms from the executive branch would be a more competent and more motivated FDA commissioner. There could be a creation of a sort of ombudsman function. The Latin is who watches the watchers. And the ombudsman function, which I proposed long, long ago, would have three characteristics. It would be outside the purview of the FDA commissioner. It would have the requisite scientific and regulatory and legal expertise to judge FDA's judgments. And most important, it would have the ability to exert negative sanctions on FDA bureaucrats who transgress. The latter seemed problematic at the time, but that becomes more likely now for a couple of reasons that I'll get to. FDA could end prosecutions for off-label promotion as long as the information conveyed is accurate, and the Assistant Secretary for Health could assume line responsibility, management over FDA. That was ended during the Clinton administration when the Assistant Secretary became merely advisory to the Secretary without actual oversight over CDC and NIH and FDA. There are various ways that Congress has already begun to reform FDA. There's the Congressional Review Act, which ex post facto can review and reverse not only regulations, but also guidances and statements or clarifications of policy. There's the RAINS Act, which is sort of the flip side of the Congressional Review Act. It requires an affirmative approval by Congress of significant regulations defined as those with more than $100 million a year impact. There's the Hyman rule, which the House just resurrected, which enables any member of Congress to append to a spending bill a recommendation to reduce the salary or eliminate an entire program from executive branch agencies. Then there's the Merit Act, which has been just introduced into the House, which would effectively enable the executive branch agencies to fire recalcitrant or incompetent or insubordinate employees. So it would effectively overrule civil service protections. And then there's reciprocity, which I and others have suggested, so that that would say that when a drug is approved by FDA or its A-list counterparts abroad, the product would automatically be approved in the other agencies. And that goes to Professor Hyman's comments about increasing the supply of available drugs. And that concludes my presentation. Thank you.
Excellent. So first I should applaud the CLI for bringing us such well-informed, erudite panelists. And also, interestingly to me, as moderator, each of them actually shares a kind of underlying, as Professor Hyman put it, background assumption about looking at some of these very complicated issues from a fairly similar framework, namely a simple one but a profound one, looking at type 1 versus type 2 errors and thinking about costs and benefits, both with respect to what the FDA is doing and what the FDA is not doing. So many of you have probably been at different types of panels, and you might not understand at least how profound it is to have this shared framework. I tried to think as I read all the papers of how I could take credit. I think I can take some credit because Sophia was my torts student, a very able torts student. And in torts and regulatory work, we often try to apply similar kinds of frameworks. But what that does mean is now as moderator, we can actually engage, and I have some questions where I want to try to tease out actually some remarkable differences amongst our speakers, notwithstanding sharing this shared framework. So it's exciting to me because oftentimes panelists will just speak past one another and they're, you know, adopting a kind of sociological perspective versus an efficiency perspective, and it's not all that interesting. These speakers all kind of share this common framework for looking at these issues, but I'd like to try to provoke them a little bit so that we can see where some differences arise. So the first question that I have for each of them is to, in response to the other panelists as well, to try to defend their respective conception of the mission and jurisdiction of the FDA. So each of them is very astutely aware that while the common layman's perspective on the FDA is they're simply about safety and efficacy of drugs, most people understand they have to approve drugs and maybe it's too fast or too slow. But interestingly, and each of them is aware of this, the FDA increasingly has gotten involved by grants of market exclusivity, et cetera, in competition policy, in intellectual property protection, right? There's a way in which market exclusivity is a safety FDA organization kind of stepping in to allow kind of quasi patents on certain types of drugs, et cetera. And interestingly, I sense, at least from the paper, a divide amongst our panelists as to whether they would be willing to have the FDA's jurisdiction increase. For Professor Hyman, the question when he says they should look to pricing, one question I have for him is, don't they do this already with all of their grants of market exclusivity? Professor Paradise mentioned some of these as well with the legislation as well as regulations. Is the idea they're not doing that enough? They should do more of it. Dr. Miller warns in his paper that we need less, not more, of the heavy hand of government involved in research and development, commercialization, and reimbursement. So what What is this sort of proper, adequate domain for the FDA? And I'd like you all to kind of push at each other a little bit. But we'll start perhaps with in the order in which you spoke on that question.
It's an interesting question. The patent issues and the marketing exclusivity issues have some things in common, but some things are different. So the orphan drug status and the UDI marketing exclusivity are not the same as a regular branded drug. And most of my focus was on generics, which has a very different set of dynamics, especially when you're seeing pricing increases because of either supply problems or monopolization problems. There's a section in the paper at the end that talks about the risks of unleashing the pricing genie within the halls of the FDA because it's not historically thought of that as its bailiwick. It doesn't have personnel that pay attention to that. It's explicitly disclaimed it on numerous occasions. I don't view, and maybe I'm being unduly optimistic, but I don't view this as setting them up as a pricing czar or of more of the heavy hand of government. I actually think it's trying to compensate for the failure of the current structure of government because they're not paying attention to pricing, and that has real competitive and human consequences as well as financial consequences. So I'm not sure there's any inconsistency with Dr. Miller's position. We might usefully discuss whether they're going to be up to the task given some of the failures that he's cataloged and the lengthy delays, right? The thing about pricing is the damage is immediate, and the longer you delay, the bigger the numbers are, which is why the reverse payments problem. Do people know what reverse payments are? So this is where a branded company pays a generic company to stay off the market, and they can pay them hundreds of millions of dollars because they make so much money by not having generic competition, by retaining effectively their patent for a longer period than would be authorized. That's a real competition failure. That's a real financial failure. I think better coordination between the FTC and the FDA may, baby steps, right? In terms of Professor Paradise's, I'm not sure I see the same direct tension. The precision medicine issue involves lots of open questions and how much of this is fluff and branding as opposed to legitimate, real changes, I think remains to be seen. But I'm not sure, unless you tell me a little more, why there's an inconsistency.
Doctor, we'll wait till we get to Dr. Miller to see whether he wants to embrace your new, proposal for the jurisdiction, but I guess I saw a parallel, and maybe Professor Paradise, you could speak to this too, on her point about the biosimilars and trying to get the biosimilars to track the generic entry gives the FDA this opportunity to be engaged not only with thinking about safety and efficacy, but thinking about things like competition policy, innovation, et cetera.
I see the point.
Doing that already. So what more do they need to do?
Well, I think if the approval process runs the same way the Hatch-Waxman approval process for generics runs, there'll be competitive consequences for more rapidly accepting biosimilars, but you can have the same kinds of problems where if you're not paying attention to the market structure and you're not paying attention to the pricing, which is a feedback about the market structure, you may set the wrong priorities for how quickly you're approving things. You may miss the fact that somebody's consolidated the market and you have biosimilars, but they're not actually exerting pricing discipline. And I don't think the FDA would view Hatch-Waxman as being about paying attention to pricing. It views Hatch-Waxman as being about, here's a pathway for approving generics, that the pricing consequences are the FTC's problem, or they're the PBM's problem, or they're Medicare's problem. Our problem is, we're the safety and efficacy, or the quality safety and efficacy agency. So we'll stop there.
Okay, I think I have three points I want to make here. The first one, I'm going to put my administrative law hat on and say, Congress didn't tell FDA to do that, to look at cost, and I think that's the FDA's position. We look at safety and efficacy. We haven't been mandated to look at cost. If you look at their mission, it is this basic balance between approving safe and effective drugs, but also promoting innovation. There's nothing in there that talks about cost, and I think FDA internalizes that. There's a couple of points that I want to bring up on the cost issue of what FDA could do, though, and. One of those is provisions built into the Affordable Care Act with PCORI, the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute. And so what is the role for comparative effectiveness? FDA doesn't do that balance when it's or do that consideration when it's looking at whether to approve a new drug. It's is it safe and is it effective? Unless it's making comparative claims, it's not going to look at comparisons between that and an existing drug. Or if it's a generic, obviously they're going to be doing the bioequivalence inquiry. So that's a really big piece of it. But PCORI, the creation of that institute in the Affordable Care Act, created this mission to undertake comparative effectiveness research. And so there's funding going on in that area, and it's an open question on how that information that's being generated through the PCORI process is going to be linked to FDA approval. So I think that's something that Congress is still thinking about. And I would have to look at the 21st Century Cures Act to see if anything made its way in there with that relationship or that connection and what might develop in the future. The other point that I want to make, the FDA has been very clear when it won't act, when it doesn't think that it needs to act. Cost is one of them, pricing cost for drugs. The other is, and I wanted to make this point because David had brought up REMS provisions. There is a very different patent procedure laid out in the Biologics Price Competition and Innovation Act, which is part of the Affordable Care Act, which created the biosimilar pathway to market. And Congress, in its wisdom, decided the procedures for Hatch-Waxman, paragraph 4 certification, which created this ability for reverse payments, they didn't like it. So they decided that they were going to create a different system for biologics. And it's a more private back and forth type of a communication between the biosimilar and the innovator. And it's raised all sorts of questions for reviewing courts. The Supreme Court is actually taking up two of those questions, dealing with when the biosimilar needs to give, or if it even does, information to the innovator product about its product. And there's also a notice provision that is being tackled by the Supreme Court as well. And that's one area where the FDA has said, look, I know we are tasked with administering this statute, but that is strictly a patent issue, and we don't do patent stuff. And so that's another area where they've been very explicit in that. So I think I'll end there.
Having long been a science nerd, I don't really have much to say about pricing directly. I go mainly to issues surrounding safety and efficacy, and then I let others, such as those on this panel, worry about the pricing issues. But I will say one thing. There's one wild card that we haven't talked about, and that's that in some instances, the CDC does weigh in on price, or more accurately, on cost effectiveness. So for determining which vaccines go on the regular recommended schedule, they sometimes decide that a vaccine simply isn't cost-effective enough. That was the case for a meningitis B vaccine, where CDC decided that it would only recommend it for high-risk children, and that the consequence of a few dozen deaths of college students or losing limbs from meningitis B was not sufficient to warrant the cost for more widespread use of this safe and very effective vaccine. The other comment I would make is that I believe that, again, other things being equal, increasing the supply of drugs will put downward pressure on prices. And so there are a number of things that the new regime at FDA can do to get more products into the marketplace. So for example, a few years ago, the director of the FDA's rheumatology drugs division decided that on a new criterion besides safety and efficacy for a drug, and that was superiority. So it would have to show superiority over existing drugs for rheumatoid arthritis in order to be approved. It's a very difficult standard to meet, partly because unless there's a huge difference in efficacy, you need very, very large numbers to show a difference, to show superiority. If a drug works in, say, 60% of the patients who will receive it, two different drugs may work in a different 60%. And so it's an entirely unreasonable standard, which should be explicitly eliminated. And then we did talk about reciprocity already, which has the advantage not only of getting more drugs on the market as they're approved elsewhere, but also would enable very similar drugs to be used in this country for drugs of which there are shortages. And drug shortages are a tremendous problem these days, especially for some sterile injectables. Last point I would like to make goes to biosimilars. There's this kind of mythology that biosimilars are only a recent development, and that the biosimilars pathway created by Congress is going to be monumental. Biosimilars, by any other name, have been around for a long, long time. FDA, with its institutional memory, is aware that there have been problems with drugs that, with biologics that seem to be identical, are supposed to be identical, but clinically are very different. And so erythropoietin is an example, human growth hormone is another example. So I think many of the guesstimates of the financial impact of biosimilars are wildly exaggerated.
Excellent. So one more. Our panel, as you know, is called the FDA Challenges for a New Century. So I'd like to engage each of you on thinking about that in terms of each of you have talked kind of about from a normative ideal, maybe what some pressing reforms or way forward for the FDA might be. I'd like you to consider what you think the prospects of these are in this new century. We have a new president. We have Congress who has put forward various initiatives that we've seen at least the outlines of, the RAINS Act, et cetera. Do we think, how do you think that as a pragmatic, practical, political matter, the FDA will be able to meet some of the challenges for a new century? And if I could, I'd like each of you too to think back to, you know, our type one, type two kind of framework, particularly if you're going to be pushing a kind of more deregulatory, so certainly Dr. Miller pushes a very much a deregulatory kind of normative view for the pre-market clearance. Do you think that correspondingly needs that we need to beef up post-market surveillance? So in other words, if we're getting drugs to the market faster, lowering some of these regulatory barriers, should we be thinking more seriously about what should go on in the post-market surveillance sphere? That would be one question. And then again, thinking about this, and Professor Paradise, you mentioned your administrative law hat, so obviously lots of things are going on in the executive sphere that will impact all agencies. Is there anything that you think the FDA will be impacted differently in terms of, for each of you as well, thinking about a new political administration, new initiatives in Congress? So that's a small question for each of you to respond to, like you did previously.
Can I start?
Sure.
Is it okay?
Yeah, that's fine.
I really liked the framework that Henry had put up about congressional pressures on administrative agencies and the Congressional Review Act. Enacted in 1996, but it's now on the table for all sorts of things, and I think that's going to be a really big issue for the FDA, because the way that the Congressional Review Act defines rule is much broader than a rule in the regulation notice and comment sense. And that's getting very real right now. And I think the focus, Congress is focusing on EPA rules right now, but there's also other issues that they're looking at. So I think that is a very strong piece of legislation that's going to have an impact on the agency. I also want to put on the table Trump's executive order, which I do not yet understand. Maybe someone in this room can explain it to me and how it's going to work, but it's an executive order signed, which directs agencies when they are promulgating a regulation to identify two regulations to repeal. I don't know what that means for the FDA. I don't know what it means, especially when they are in many pieces of legislation specifically tasked with promulgating regulations. So I think that I just wanted to put that on the list as well, because I can't quite wrap my head around how that's going to impact the agency.
Yeah, I think in answer to Jordan's question, if I remember right, the healthcare regulations are exempt from that, so they don't have to do the two for one.
Well, there's the answer.
I think that's the answer to that part. As to Professor Sharkey's question about whether there should be increased surveillance with decreased scrutiny, I think there should be, and that's particularly apropos of the right to try legislation that now exists in a number of states and is proposed at the federal level. I'm not against the principle, but the way that it's being suggested that patients would have the right to try a completely unapproved drug after phase one testing is much too lenient a standard. Phase one testing is virtually no testing at all. Doesn't give you an indication of the correct dose, doesn't give you any real indication of the potential side effects. And so I think that's just theoretical pie in the sky and unreasonable. But let's say that it was implemented more reasonably with an indication, a reasonable likelihood of efficacy as a result of phase two studies, I think absolutely there should be increased scrutiny and data collection of patients who opt to take it under the right to try provisions.
So Dr. Miller scooped my observation about right to try and post-market surveillance. I think, you know, more post-market surveillance certainly seems sensible. We should do more of it. What should be done with it is a second order and separate question. In terms of your sort of framing, though, about, well, put on the, you know, your look at the crystal ball, I guess I'd make three observations. The first is that, you know, if you look at the ads for financial services products, it always says past performance is no predictor of future results. But I think when you look at administrative agencies, Hyman's law is everything runs on autopilot, right? You just keep doing what you were doing before unless some external force that's big enough and important enough makes a difference. And I think the open question that Dr. Paradise has pointed to and Professor Paradise has pointed to and Dr. Miller's slides point out is it's very much an open question how much either Congress or the executive branch are going to exert themselves and in which directions and with what effects. I would fully expect to see an orgy of leaking about the horrific consequences that will follow from this regulation or that proposal, and you know the identifiable victims of those things, and we'll see whether and when there'll be pushback and where we'll end up on the sort of Goldilocks spectrum of too fast, too slow, or just right.
I'm going to invite now the audience to ask questions. It would be great, I think, I'll just assume this is so since I see microphones, to have folks line up at the microphones. Sophia, is that right? Because I think this is being recorded. And I'll also take moderator's prerogative to say we want to get a lot of robust questions in, so if you could be brief in your questions so we can get through them, that would be wonderful. Professor Professor Sage.
Thanks, Kathy. Okay, could you guys talk a little bit more specifically to drug regulation about the relationship between Congress and the FDA? Because that's the piece. I mean, so Henry talked a lot about kind of this Congress wanting to blow up the regulatory state, and Jordan talked, forgive me, about the 21st Century Cures Act as if it's some beautifully thought through piece of legislation that is going to somehow reset the regulatory design in the area. But we all know that Congress and the FDA work in a very different kind of rhythm vis-a-vis one another. And if you could talk a little about the big picture there, I'd be grateful.
Let's get some more questions.
Each panelist need not respond, but I'll step in if necessary, but otherwise someone should.
I mean, I can speak to the 21st Century Cures Act comment. In no way was I saying it's a beautiful piece of legislation, everyone's in harmony and it's great. I think my focus was specifically on what it could do in a perfect world for companion diagnostics because of the flexibility that's built into it. With that said, I think it creates a lot of problems for the Food and Drug Administration too. I mean, it's a lot of the provisions are extremely unclear on what it means for the FDA. Are they supposed to issue guidance, or are they supposed to do something through regulation? What does it mean to consider something? They're tasked with doing a lot of reports to Congress, and so I think Congress is looking for information and some more feedback on how the FDA is doing things in a certain realm. I mean, that's really what the legislation is about. As far as the general relationship between Congress and the FDA, I think increasingly because of lobbying efforts and industry being more and more concerned with the amount of regulations, Congress has started to pay more attention to what the FDA is doing or not doing. And so I think implementation of that 21st Century Cures Act is going to be key. I don't know what it's going to look like.
Henry, did you
want to say something? That's a very important question in view of some of these new initiatives. So, for example, the Hyman rule, when it was resurrected about a month ago, there was a headline in the Washington Post. New initiative can reduce bureaucrats' pay to $1 a year. And that's conceivable, but who's going to decide that? The actual action has to come from a member of Congress appending that recommendation to a spending bill. So how will they know whom to zing? FDA will have to suggest some list, perhaps, of insubordinate or incompetent employees for that, I guess, unless it's going to be adversarial, but who knows? Up till now, FDA has had a very limited ability and almost no success in sanctioning underperforming or misbehaving employees. As I mentioned, the trade associations have been woefully inadequate. They could certainly suggest that people like the division director who proposed superiority, the geniuses at the Center for Veterinary Medicine who came up with treating whole animals as though they were veterinary drugs if they're genetically engineered, they should certainly be candidates for walking the plank. But how that'll happen, whether that'll happen, who knows?
How about the next Francis
Kelsey? Sure.
Okay. Do you want to introduce yourself briefly too?
Sure. My name is Lisa Kearns. I'm from the Division of Medical Ethics. I work extensively in compassionate use and right to try, and I was very heartened by what you both said about right to try. I can ask you later. I'm wondering what you think the odds are of this passing, because I've heard no chance and it's a done deal. But my question was about reciprocity, and if we're going to accept the judgment of, I think you called them A-list countries, or Japan, the EU, and things like that, is the result going to be kind of a division of labor? If we're going, if everybody's approval is going to be accepted, and if not, what wouldn't be approved here in the U.S. that perhaps was approved in Japan or the EU, and why not? I mean, what wouldn't we approve based on what they did?
Well, there's almost 100% overlap eventually, of drugs that are approved in Europe and Japan and here and Australia, New Zealand. Drug approvals are a judgment call. It's a judgment about the risks and benefits. And so even among FDA reviewers in a single division, you'll get a spectrum of opinions sometimes. So there will be slight differences, but I think very slight. And that's why we should limit it to A-list counterparts that have pretty much the same quality of review.
Professor Robertson.
Thanks, good morning. Christopher Robertson from University of Arizona, visiting here at NYU this year. I wanted to revisit some of the framing comments that Dr. Hyman offered, and I think Dr. Miller also pointed to, suggesting that regulators have these asymmetric incentives, making them more worried about false positives than false negatives, worried about bad drugs that do get approved. I wonder if we need to reconsider that in the age of social media, in the age of lobbying, in the age of campaign finance, because when you look at the cases of recent drug approvals, patient advocacy communities have been very powerful and very activated, and they have actually flipped this concern about identified versus statistical lives, because it'll actually bring the little boy and give the anecdote that, oh, he received the drug and he benefited from it, so if you don't approve this drug, you are going to hurt Johnny. And we actually seen this play out in several recent drug approvals. And then Johnny's backed up by a multi-million dollar lobbying campaign. And I'm not saying that's good or bad. I'm just saying that as analysts, we may need to go back to a moment of sort of equipoise about which way the bias is run, because I think we've seen, and there's reasons to believe, there's other studies that show the effect of lobbying has a huge rate of return on investment. So maybe we need to go back to agnosticism about which way the scale is tilted.
Yeah, so I thought I'd said, I made the general point, and then I said, unless the patient advocacy groups are involved in the space, I thought I had said that, and if I didn't, I apologize. You're certainly correct that, the dynamic that I described is dependent on one being visible and the other being invisible. And the more you have organized patient groups that can make the invisible visible, the less unbalanced the scales will start to look. I just make 2 points in response. The first is there's a long history of the false positives resulting in administrative crucifixion, and making noise by patient advocacy groups is not quite the same thing as being called to an oversight hearing to excoriate you for your failure. Particularly if it's not just little Johnny, but it's 10,000 people that were injured by a drug. People's memories are long on the bad things that happened to them and their predecessors for approving something that they didn't. And you might, it's ultimately an empirical question whether the scales are sufficiently balanced. That's not the same thing as being agnostic, right? So.
Well, until we know the answer.
Well, we have a long list of ones that were false positives and a couple that were false negatives where patient advocacy groups made enough noise to move the ball. That's not being agnostic. That's a sizable data set. But maybe we just disagree on that.
We also have 35 state legislatures passing rights to drive, for example, which is an example of new social media.
Which is also an indication of the dissatisfaction with the dynamics that prevail even in the age of social media.
Sophia?
Dr. Hyman, I was struck by your anecdote about human insulin that it took your team 5 months, whereas the average time was about 31 months, especially in light of Professor Hyman's comments that as long as you treat everyone in the queue equally, then business is chugging along as usual. So I'm curious as to the cultural aspect of what you experienced at the FDA and what kind of conversations were happening among teams or internally within the agency that accounts for why, without an expedited approval process, some things were happening in 5 months and some were taking the average time.
Well, that's an opportune question because there's a good anecdote about that. My team was actually ready at 4 months. to approve the drug. And I went to my supervisor and I said, okay, here's the summary, here's the evaluation, and we're ready to approve it. And he said, 4 months? No way. If anything goes wrong, people will say we rushed it. And I don't know how long he intended to sit on it, but in about a month, he went on vacation, and I went to the division director, and he signed off on it. I can tell you this was not a crowd pleaser from my supervisor, but that's how the 5 months, and that's a perfect illustration of the type 1, type 2 dichotomy. He wasn't worried about this superior, he wasn't concerned about this superior insulin being delayed. He was worrying about negative blowback if there were any problem with this at all once it was available to the 4 million, at the time, 4 million type 1 diabetics who could start injecting this.
Professor Epstein.
Oh, my God. Thank you. I wanted to press a little bit on something which you talked about, main David talked about, but never elaborated, which is the role of exclusive grants and the way in which the FDA operates. I've always been deeply opposed to these things as an incentive mechanism, and the explanation is you put them out there, it's a sort of off-budget type financing, and you have no idea exactly what the cost is, and no idea of the relationship or the benefit that's provided by the studies or the dislocations that have been done, and yet it seems to me that these things have very strong pricing effects for the reasons that you mentioned. So your proposal was that the FDA should look at the prices. Isn't it probably a better thing to sort of reconsider from the ground up whether exclusivity periods as a reward structure is an appropriate way to do things, or whether or not if Congress wants to do something, it makes a budgetary appropriation in order to get the desired result? This is a question for all of you, but I suppose, David, you're first on the firing line.
So I take it you're opposed to patents?
No. Obviously not, and so forth. But the question in these particular situations is, if this stuff were patentable, then you'd certainly want to do it through patents. But I take it the exclusivity covers cases where you don't meet the patentability requirements. Studies proving that a certain drug is more effective than one might have thought of giving you an exclusive in some other area, I just don't see the relationships. And as you know, data exclusivity in some ways is a more powerful protection than is patent protection, because with patent protection, you can't stop the new molecular entity from coming in there, and data exclusivity may give you broader protection. So I'm just curious, has anyone done, because when I taught the FDA course, I did not see a systematic study as to the sort of political economy of these exclusions, because, there are a whole bunch of them, some better than others, and I'm just curious as to whether or not the huge price stuff that you see in many ways is a function of that, and it's also a function of the fact that we don't allow generics to come in as freely as we used to today, and particularly have a policy which says that if a generic is in use overseas, you can't bring it into the United States until it's tested anew. It strikes me as being utterly bizarre.
So in my limited defense, I took the existing statutory framework as a given. I still got beat up by Dr. Paradise for violating Administrative Law 101 by trying to encourage an administrative agency that, in her view, to do something outside its statutory bailiwick. I think marketing exclusivity, there's a range of them. Some of them make more sense than others. Most of them are distortionary. The question is, for what benefit and at what cost. They primarily localize the costs on the people that have the disease rather than the far larger group of individuals, including the U.S. taxpayers who, if they think there's some value in getting the drug, the UDI, onto the schedule, maybe you should offer a prize, maybe you should reimburse the cost of the trial rather than allowing people to jack up the cost of colchicine for people who not just are paying higher costs. They also have gout, and it's not like they have a huge range of alternatives. So I agree with you that marketing exclusivity has lots of distortions and anti-competitive consequences. If you're a person who cares about competition, exclusivity, particularly government-granted exclusivity, which can be leveraged to do additional things that the regulator wants, but that the regulated entity is sort of forced to do, or is throw me into that briar patch to do, are all problematic. But I took the goal of the paper and the panel to be not how should we change food and drug law, but what should the FDA do different within its existing framework.
Yeah, I think I would add to that. I mean, the exclusivity USPTO versus FDA is so complicated in that you've got the FDA can either award market or data exclusivity. It's 5 years, it's 7 years, it's 6 months. There's a lot of variation built into the statute there for what the FDA can do. And there's also patent term extension. For the time that you lost on your patent while you're developing your drug. So there's a complicated calculus that's also in there on how you can get a return. So there's so many different ways that Congress has tried to play that out. And I think also there's some novel ways where Congress has tried to think around exclusivity. There is priority review voucher programs that have been built into certain pieces of the legislation. I think that it's an open-ended question on how those have actually performed. And to answer your question directly, I don't know who's doing those studies on what has worked and what hasn't and what it's cost. I do know, I mean, I would say that I've seen work by Henry Grabowski at Duke who has done the economics on what exclusivity means in the generic context. But I think that's the only work that I've seen on that directly on that point.
Great. Mario? Hi. You know, we all know that science and scientific results are normally not unambiguous. There's disagreement. They're not conclusive. You can have very excellent scientists coming to different conclusions on the same evidence. Yet, the FDA promotes itself as this is safe and effective, period, right? Now, the interesting thing is, you know, the right to try has been presented in a certain way, but there is something more basic than that going on, and that is that you get this agency which acts as if or promotes its decisions as if they are in some ways definitive, that there is no disagreement, and that reasonable people couldn't take some of the drugs that they have rejected and still be reasonable people. Now, I'm just wondering if there any alternative to that. Maybe, you know, we're dealing with a society of people who are essentially children and need to be told this is right and this is wrong and there's no ambiguity. But one of the things that bothers me is this. You know, I know in science there's always this ambiguity, and yet, you know, this is approved, this is good, take it, and that's not approved, you can't take it. Somehow, I would like to see some give on that.
Well, emphatically, FDA does not judge that something is absolutely safe and effective. It makes the judgment that the risks and benefits are appropriate for administration of the drug under defined conditions to a defined population. I think there are some mechanisms, some of which Jordan delineated, that loosen the standard. So there's accelerated approval, which is a sort of conditional approval based not on a definitive, in quotes, definitive clinical outcome, but based on surrogate endpoints. And that requires a confirmatory study after the drug is available on the market. There have been other proposals for more frequent conditional approvals based on just a reasonable expectation or some language like that of clinical safety and effectiveness. So, yeah, there have been various attempts to bend or make more lenient the standard.
Yeah, are we out of time? I think the only thing I would add to that is I think you're right that the attitude of many FDA personnel and their enthusiastic supporters is that but for them, snake oil and Laetril would be the only thing that was out there. Their hostility.
What's wrong with Laetril?
No, I'm only kidding. One went to the Supreme Court, yeah. Right? Those of you who don't remember, this is the peach pits that supposedly can treat cancer, right? And it was offered under circumstances that were associated with selling snake oil. And, you know, so they upheld FDA authority to basically say not here, not now, not ever, unless they get approval. But the other point I was going to make is, you know, the FDA skepticism about off-label marketing backed up by, you know, felony prosecutions is that not only are the American public incapable of making their own decisions about risks and benefits, you should have real skepticism about doctors' abilities to make their own judgments when they're subjected to, you know, persuasive advertising by pharmaceutical companies, right? You don't end up with REMS that limit, you know, the circumstances under which doctors can use things if you really believe that the FDA only does drugs and doctors can do the practice of medicine all by them lonesome.
I'll make one comment just because there's a minute left, which is, you know, we haven't talked about, but and obviously you're aware, you know, the FDA has advisory committees of scientists and others, and oftentimes it becomes public that the advisory committee voted, you know, 15-4. So the public reads the newspaper, they're going to understand that there's some scientific disagreement. There are also sometimes very high profile examples, like there was a high potency opioid drug that the FDA approved against the recommendation of its advisory committee. And then it engages presumably the public into some kind of debate as to the influence of things other than scientific expertise, et cetera. And in that one high profile controversy, you even had the governor in Massachusetts banning that drug. So then you had interesting federalism issues of if the FDA approves a drug, does it mean you have to sell it in your state? And what if you decide, you know, that you don't think the FDA is the be all end all? So I think there's some legal controversies at least that would suggest there's an argument too in terms of state and other public resistance to seeing the FDA as the be all end all. Yes, Dr. Miller. Yeah. Good that I provoked you. The final word.
Professor Sharkey's comment about the advisory committees brings up a broader issue, and that's what's been referred to as regulatory creep. And that's not, that doesn't indict any individual at FDA, I should point out. But advisory committees, when I was at FDA, were convened very rarely, and they were usually to discuss some generic issue, like whether it was appropriate to use malignant cell lines to produce pharmaceuticals, or a very difficult risk-benefit judgment on an individual drug. Now they're convened all the time for anything and everything, and most often to provide a fig leaf for FDA. And often FDA channels, to put it kindly, channels their decisions by crafting the questions that they're asked to opine on very narrowly, and they've become less valuable. Other examples of that are REMS, where FDA has the muscle to require virtually whatever it wants for REMS, again, encroaching, more and more regulatory creep. And another is FDA's demand for phase four studies. They used to be relatively rare. Phase four post-marketing studies used to be to find safety and efficacy in groups that were underrepresented in the original clinical studies. But now they seem to be de rigueur for, almost all the time, just because FDA can do it. They do it.
Okay, great. So we started early. We're ending on time. But please join me in thanking these wonderful panelists.